draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Cause nothing else could take your place to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way, bring me back to you.
Well, as the slide says there, our God is an awesome God. And thank you to Amy for providing us with that musical interlude to put our hearts right, to make our souls in tune with God. Because we're being given an opportunity, aren't we? And that is to give God the worship he deserves and to be fed through worship. Because we know it's not an easy world in which we're living, and these are not easy times that we're going through right now. That's why we need the Word of God to lift us physically, emotionally, and spiritually. So we thank you you're back with us today as we worship on this Sunday, or whatever time that you are watching this video, this worship service. We've received some good news this week, just late, very late in the week, that we have been approved for reopening. Now, we'll give you some information this week as to what our plans are, what a date is, because as we know, we just received this approval, but the numbers are starting to go up in the province. And just as we came out here to start to film the service, we received an update about more restrictions being put in place about gatherings. So we need to look at those and then make a decision. But the good news is we have been given finally permission, so we've got that hurdle overlooked. So an email will go out, letters will go out, phone calls will go out as we make a decision this week what is going to be the safest date for us to reopen. But remember that word, the safest date, because we want to make sure you're comfortable when we do return. And remember, no pressure on anyone. Come when you are ready, because we're going to continue to offer these services as well once we are regathering and reopen. So let us lift our hearts up to God this day as we offer our praise and worship. And we begin with welcome to to this house.
Welcome to this house, we come to worship. Welcome to this house, we come to pray. Welcome to this house, where we
join with me in our call to worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
On this third Sunday of the month, we always do this liturgy, a prayer to catch one's breath. And as we know, after God created Adam, what did he do? He breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, the breath that gives us soul. The breath we need, a prayer to catch one's breath. Let us join together. May I be still now and know that you are God. Help me to catch my breath today. May you breathe in me, Lord, and fill me with your spirit. May you calm me, Lord, and fill me with your peace and love. May you enlighten me and fill me with your wisdom, Lord. May you strengthen me, Lord, and remove my anxieties and worries. May you bless me, Lord, as I worship you with true joy in my heart. Amen. Let us join in singing our opening piece today in Christ Alone.
Let's go.
in Christ alone. Before we pray, let us say we come to ask your forgiveness. As we look at this world in which we live, when we see the brokenness, when we see the pain and the suffering, the anguish and the crying, we know that we couldn't get through a day without you, because you give us hope. You give us your power. You give us life, life eternal, that reminds us that this is just our temporary home. That we know it won't always be the way it is, like we're seeing right now with the pandemic, what we're seeing with acts of violence, what we're seeing with unselfishness and all types of things going on. It's not a pleasant world. And it must bring tears to you as it brings tears to us at times. But something else that brings tears to you is when we sin. You see it. Because you're all knowing. You're always present. You see the times when we have thoughts that are impure. When we say things that don't reflect love. When we take steps into the darkness. When we embrace sin instead of righteousness. The tears flow. Because you know the hurts that is happening in us and in others by our actions and our thoughts and our deeds. We know, God, you call us to a way of righteous living, and that is our desire each and every day. But for those times that we haven't done that, make it known to us. And for those times where we have been sinful, call us to repentance and hear our confessions. Because we want to be a repentant people. We want to be a forgiven child of yours. So God, hear our cries and hear our petitions as we lay them before you, knowing that they are being laid on holy ground before you, knowing that you are taking those sins, ripping them up and saying, my child, you are forgiven. So thank you, God, for doing that for us once again, because we know it is a wonderful and blessed feeling to experience the peace and the joy that comes with forgiveness and mercy. So help us, God, to sin less and to obey and honor you more in the things that we say, the things that we think, and the things that we do. We offer this prayer in Christ's name, who taught each and every one of us when to pray to say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please join with me in our response to God's gift of grace. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
I invite Don Pritchard to come forward now for our special music.
Into the
Well, as Don's song pointed out, that is one way that our Lord speaks to us, isn't it? He gives us a song. And I've often said it's a song in our hearts. You know, that time that we need it most, great is His faithfulness. Or maybe on one of those bad days that all of a sudden you find yourself singing or humming, God will take care of you. It's a way He speaks to us. And we need to realize it's just one of the ways that God cares for us, is putting that song in our hearts, giving us that song when we need it the most. And we just thank you, God, for giving us that message, that reminder through that special music today. This is the third Sunday of the month, and it's always New Life Sunday here at Mount Pleasant. And we always look at the Ten Commandments on New Life Sunday. As we know, after God rescued the Israelites out of Egypt, He led them to Mount Sinai. And when they arrived, they entered into a covenant ceremony with God, where He would be their God and they would be His people. And then He gave them the Ten Commandments. And as you look at these commandments, they were meant for one thing: to teach these Israelites how they could be in a proper relationship with God and as well live in a proper relationship with one another and community with one another. These commandments have stood the test of time. These commandments are meant to guide our lives, to bless our lives, to strengthen our lives. Let us join together in God's Ten Commandments today. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make any graven image of any kind. You shall not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against thy neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house, nor his servants, nor his ox, nor anything that is your neighbor's. Amen. Before we look at the word of God, let us sing Where the Spirit of the Lord Is. Scripture reading for today. Let us come before God in our prayer for understanding. Let us pray. Gracious and most holy God, we need your voice. We need your words. We need your message. Because we're living in very uncertain times, very confusing times, a time where the brokenness of our world is so much in our forefront. To see the death, to see the pestilence, to see the anger and violence and racism, to see everything that we are in this world. It can deplete us. It can beat us up. It can tear us down. But your word does the opposite. It builds us up. It encourages us. It strengthens us. It nourishes us. It gives us the hope and life and light we need to keep going, keep persevering, and keep enduring. So God, speak to us. Speak to us loudly, passionately, clearly, so that we can be fed in the most amazing of ways through the Word of God. Sustain us, God. Empower us, God, as we devote this time to you. We offer our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. The passage I want us to look at today is from John chapter 11. It takes place immediately after Jesus raised Lazarus back to life, after Lazarus had been dead in the grave for 4 days. As you can imagine, people were talking. And people were actually going back to the religious leaders and telling them everything that had happened there. Because Bethany, where this miracle took place, was just 2 miles from Jerusalem. So the religious leaders began to talk. And it was at this point that they made formal plans to kill Jesus. Because as Caiaphas was about to point out, isn't it better for one person to die than for a nation? So let us listen and learn from the Word of God today, John 11, verses 45 to 54. Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. What are we accomplishing, they asked. Here is this man performing many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And then the Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation. Then one of them, named Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, spoke up. You know nothing at all. You do not realize that it is better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish. He did not say this on his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation, and not only for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one. So from that day on, they plotted to take his life. Therefore, Jesus no longer moved about publicly among the people of Judea. Instead, he withdrew to a region near the wilderness, to a village called Ephraim, where he stayed with his disciples. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, September 11th, 2020, took place about 9 days ago. And isn't it hard to believe? That marked the 19th anniversary of the September 11th terrorist attacks. We remember that day. How could we forget that day? We all remember where we were when we first heard of the attacks. And then, turning on the television and seeing and witnessing it with our own eyes. To see the planes crashing into the buildings in the Pentagon. To see the Twin Towers come crashing down. To see people fleeing for their lives as the dust began to erupt. To see the heroism of the firefighters and the first responders. And then to see the events afterwards. It's a day that changed this world. Over almost 3,000 people died on September 11th, 2001. Another 6,000 people were injured on that day. And as we know, the planes were grounded for at least 4 days. And when society began to get back together, to resume after that attack, we saw a different world. To go to an airport, all of a sudden, we had to go through intensive security procedures. Our sense of safety and well-being were not the same. Were we afraid and frightened? Worried that another terrorist attack could happen? Worried about our own well-being? And then we began to see wars happen. Wars on terror. It began with the war in Afghanistan. Deaths began to happen. In Afghanistan, we began to see 2,372 U.S. soldiers killed during that conflict. We not only heard about deaths, we heard about injuries. 20,320 U.S. soldiers were wounded in action. And we also heard about civilians being killed. Civilians living in Afghanistan, and even civilian contractors who came in and part of the rebuilding process. Over 1,720 civilian contractors were killed in Afghanistan. U.S. soldiers were killed and wounded. But so too were Canadian soldiers. Yes, it affected us, 9/11. We were part of the war in Afghanistan. Do you remember the soldiers who were killed? 158. 158 Canadian soldiers were killed in Afghanistan. Many more were wounded. 1,800 of our soldiers were wounded in action. And as well, much money was spent. In Canada alone, $18 billion were spent on the war and the rebuilding efforts. 9/11 changed this world. It began a war on terror, a war that began in Afghanistan and continued in Iraq. As we know, because of the fear of weapons of mass destruction, it led to the war in Iraq. More deaths. Many more deaths. 4,424 U.S. soldiers killed in Iraq. Many more wounded. 31,952. But as we know, in such a conflict, civilians get killed too. You know, during the war in Iraq, this isn't just from U.S. conflict as well. This is some of the sectarian violence that was going on. Over 182,000 to 200,000 civilians were injured or dead. Where did it begin? 9/11. An event associated with death. An event that changed the world. Not for the better. 19 years later, there's another event associated with death that has changed our world. COVID-19. It has been deadly, hasn't it? We have seen this many cases, over 27 million cases worldwide. And it's growing and growing each day, isn't it? Of the 27 million, 18 million have recovered. There's still over 9 million active cases going on in this world. And the numbers are growing. And there's been death. There's been a lot of deaths. Over 881,000 deaths worldwide. And the numbers increase each and every day. It has changed our world, hasn't it? Borders were closed. Societies and economies were shut down. Schools, businesses, government offices were shut down. We began to see restrictions on where we could go, restrictions on who we could gather with. It's changed our society. It's changed our way of life. We no longer say we expect things to go back to normal. No, we say we're expecting a new normal coming out of COVID-19. A better normal? We're not sure. It doesn't seem it, does it? It doesn't seem like it's going to be a better world coming out of it. But that is what death does. Whether it's from 9/11, whether it's from COVID-19, events connected with death can change our world. Think of cancer. It's associated with death. It can change somebody's world. Look at the forest fires out on the West Coast. There's been deaths and loss there. That is changing people's worlds. It's hurricane season. Tropical storm season. We hear of deaths with each and every one of those. And destruction. It changes people's worlds. But not for the better. Not for the better. But there's one death. Yes, there is one death. That has changed the world for the better. And as we know, that death was Jesus. And one thing we can celebrate, one thing we always need to keep in mind is this, that Jesus' death has changed our world for the better. Now, after Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, what did that do? It put into motion God's plan that one day he would come into this world as Jesus Christ, our Savior, to save us from our sins, to save us from death. So Jesus began his public ministry. And as we saw, by the time he raised Lazarus back to life, he was gathering quite a following. And why wouldn't he? With his teachings that amazed people. With performing the healings that he did and the miracles that he did. People were realizing there was something different about Jesus. And there was an expectation at that time of the Messiah, the Savior, coming. Attention was focusing on Jesus. And as we heard, when news went back to the religious leaders how Jesus raised Lazarus back to life after 4 days, they didn't like this. They realized more and more people are going to follow Jesus. Whether it be in the riot, whether it be people of gathering to arms, wanting to go to war against the Romans. Because remember, the one thing the Jewish nation hated was being occupied by another force. And they had a wrong perception about their Messiah. They thought their Messiah would lead them into arms against the Roman force and give them freedom like they had under the days of King David. So, with that misunderstanding of the work of the Savior, you can see why these religious leaders were so worried. If Rome finds out that all these people are gathering around Jesus, would they come in and shut it down? Would they destroy the temple? Would they destroy the nation? As the conversation went on, Caiaphas made this comment. You don't know what you're talking about. You don't realize that it's better for you that one man should die for the people than for the whole nation to be destroyed. Those words. It is better for one man to die. He didn't realize it, did he? That God was speaking through him. That God was prophesying that the difference about Jesus' death, about deaths that we see in other circumstances, this would make the world a better place. No, Caiaphas didn't realize he was speaking prophecy. But what happened at this point? They began to plot, seriously plot Jesus' death. So what did Jesus do? He withdrew. Now let's make it clear. Jesus wasn't afraid, no. That's not the reason he withdrew from public ministry at that time. He knew this. It wasn't the Father's time for him to die. Not at that point. A little while later, when the Jews gathered together in Jerusalem for the Passover, that was the time he resumed his public ministry, as we saw, with his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And Jesus knew this is the time for him to die. For him to die on the cross for our sins. And as we know that fateful Friday, this is exactly what Jesus did. He hung for 6 hours on the cross, crucified. The worst form of death ever devised. And as we see this picture of Jesus on the cross, we need to realize he's suffocating at this moment, gasping for breath, pushing up on his feet, as you can see on that cross, to try to relieve the pressure on his sinews, the pressure on his muscles, the pressure on his lungs, gasping for breath. And as he hung on the cross, didn't he experience the worst of society? People mocking him and making fun of him. People shaking their fists at him in anger. Even the two thieves on the cross making fun of him. People demanding that he come down from the cross if he truly is the Son of God, the Son of Man. But he endured. And at one moment, your and my sins were placed on his shoulders. Was it right? Was it fair? No. But he loves us. And he didn't want you and I to be the ones up there. All the sins of the world were put on his shoulders at this time. And after 6 hours of being on the cross, what did Jesus do? He said, "It is finished." And then he took his last breath and gave his spirit to the Lord and died. And at that moment, it seemed like every other death that we've looked at, that it hasn't made the world a better place. The disciples didn't think so. They didn't think the world was better because Jesus died. No. They were lost. They were given up hope. They were shocked. Because they had put their hopes in Jesus. And don't you think the Pharisees were rejoicing? Don't you think Satan was jumping up and down? Didn't it appear like death had the final say? It was the most powerful thing. He took a resurrection after this death for us to truly realize that there was something different about Jesus' death. That Jesus' death made this a better world. Why? Because Jesus is exactly who he says he is. The Son of God. He's not a liar. He's not a false prophet. He promised he would die and rise again. And he showed he is the Son of God. And he showed us. He's our living Lord. Our living Savior. And how exactly did Jesus' death make this a better world? Well, first of all, it made this a better world by providing us with a new identity. Because after Jesus' death and resurrection, once we put our faith and trust in him, you know what our new identity is? A forgiven child of God. Isn't that a better world for you and I? Now think about it. Would your brother be heard of an unforgiven child of God? No. What is better? I am a forgiven child of God. It's made it a better world for us. And you know what else has made it a better world? We know that part of our identity is Christ's Spirit now lives within our hearts. The Holy Spirit dwells within our hearts. Isn't it better for us to live with Christ's Spirit within us than not to have it at all? And do you know what else is part of our identity? Followers and disciples of Christ. It gives our life meaning and direction. That's the first way that Christ's death and resurrection has made this a better world for you and I. It has provided us with a new identity. The second way it's made this a better world, it has given our lives purpose and meaning. Don't so many people strive to try to find some purpose and meaning to life? But you know what the purpose and meaning to our lives are? To give God the glory. That's our purpose. That's the meaning of our lives. To use the God-given gifts and talents we have to bring glory to him, to build the kingdom of God here on earth, to do things that are lasting and eternal. It brings meaning. It brings purpose and hope to our lives. I saw an example of this morning. One of our parishioners sent me a video just yesterday, I think, and I had a chance to watch it this morning. It was called The Tap on the Shoulder. And this gentleman said he was out for supper with his wife one day, and he kind of got that nudge, that tap on his shoulder. There was a couple over there, a woman with her daughter, I believe. And this man was kind of encouraged. Just go over to this woman and tell her how lovely she looks. Now, he didn't tell his wife. So after they finished eating, they went over to the table. He knelt down right at her level and said, "I just want to tell you how lovely you look today." You know what her response was? "That's exactly what my husband would have said. And today is the first anniversary of my husband's death." You see what God did? He used that man to uplift that woman's day. A very hard day. Made an eternal difference. Not just for this woman who was grieving, but for this child of God who followed that prompting. Do you see how it brings purpose and meaning to our lives? We can do so much of it in this world, but when we realize that God is working in and through us, it brings such purpose and meaning to our lives, making it a better world for us to live in. And the other way that Jesus' death and resurrection has made this a better world, it gives us hope. Because we know the same power that God used to raise Jesus back to life, he will use to help raise us above our problems. We realize
That no matter how bad things get, that nothing is impossible for God. It gives us hope realizing that we're not alone, that God is with us. He's helping us overcome our trials and tribulations. And it gives us hope realizing it won't always be like this. No, it won't always be like this because our eternal home is in heaven. As I mentioned before, so many other deaths, as we look at COVID, as we look at 9/11, don't make this world a better place. But one death has made this world so much better. And that is the death of Christ. And what his death on the cross has accomplished for us. As we know, we are constantly bombarded by death. Whether it is a pandemic, whether it is an act of terror, whether it is acts of violence, whether it is natural disasters, we are continually bombarded by death in this world. Events that don't make this a better world. But thankfully, because of the death of Christ, we are given a special gift. The gift of hope. The gift of a new identity, the gift of meaning and purpose that allows us to continue to endure no matter what we are experiencing. And to remind us of this gift, I want to give you an analogy from boxing. Now, maybe some of you like boxing, maybe some of you don't. But if you've ever watched it, you know one of the punches that an opponent always does is the jab. So they'll start off and go jab, 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 jab. And what is that meant to do? To throw your opponent off. To kind of stun them. Hurt them a bit. And what are those jabs meant to do? It's meant to set up for the cross. See where I'm going with it? What does COVID do? It's a jab. Every time we hear news of rising numbers, it's a jab. And what does it do? It sets us back. When we hear acts of terror, what does it do? It's a jab. Sets us back. When we hear of death with cancer, when we hear death of forest fires, when we hear other deaths, it's another jab, isn't it? But thankfully, we have the cross. We have the power of the cross. And it is through the power of the cross, it's through the death of Jesus that has made this a better place for us to live. Other deaths could not do it, but one death did. And that's why we believe. That's why we have hope. And that's why we have power, no matter what we are going through now. Whether it's COVID, whether it's terror, what? Remember, the power of the cross. God bless and amen.
When I need to know someone cares.
Well, as I've always said, I'm always amazed how God is at work in a service. I didn't receive that video of the tap on the shoulder till Friday night, and I didn't look at it till today on Saturday as we filmed this. Don had no idea, and I had no idea what Don was going to say. But that hand on the shoulder, wasn't that brought out in that video, in the message? And that is God reminding us He is there in the most unique, in the most special of ways. So thank you, God, for hearing the Lord's voice, and this is the song He wanted you to sing today. Our prayers to the people. As we know, the case numbers are rising through Ontario. It's got a lot of people concerned and worried. We have to look at the numbers and see what direction it's going in. Is there a second wave or a second coming of the virus, the pandemic? Time will tell. But what we do know is we have power of prayer on our side. So let's pray as a community of faith. Gracious and all-loving God, we thank you this day, God, for reminding us that even as we come to anniversaries, like recently of the 19th anniversary of 9/11, and reminded of the many deaths and how it changed the world for not the better, you're there. You give us a means by which to make this a better world for us, and that is through the power of the cross, through what Jesus' death and resurrection accomplished for us. As we're reminded today, it's given us a new identity. It's given us new purpose and meaning in our lives, to use our gifts and talents for your glory, to do things that, unbeknownst to us, is leading others to you. Whether it's comforting them, encouraging them, uplifting them, reminding them of your presence and your love, or building the kingdom of heaven here on earth. We know, God, that you are giving us purpose and meaning, and you're giving us hope. Where would we be right now without the hope that you offer us? Hope that we'll get through this. Hope that we'll persevere. Hope that even though we may face a new reality, a new world, the new things coming out of this, that you'll be there. You'll still be speaking. You'll still be guiding. You'll still be lifting us up. And we thank you, God, for the hope that you offer us. And that is what this world needs as we see possibly another wave of the pandemic coming. So we pray for people to work together. To not be selfish. To take proper care of themselves and of others, so we don't cause these numbers to rise. We know that until a vaccine comes, we're not going to be without COVID cases. But help us to work together, to show enough care and respect and love for one another to flatten the curve again. We pray for those who are filled with worry, that you replace it with trust in you. We pray for those who are sick, that they'll recover fully from this virus. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, whether it's through COVID, whether it's through other means, to give them the strength and encouragement they need. We pray for our children in schools. We know there's been a few cases. We thank you it hasn't been rampant yet, but we pray for their safety and well-being. As we pray for the safety and well-being of our teachers and administrators, we pray that all will be well. We pray for our churches, for those that are open and those who are beginning the plans to reopen. Grant safety and peace. Speak into each person's heart if it's the right time for them to return or not. Keep worshipers safe. Continue to provide means like these online services for others. Because one thing we need right now, God, is your word. We need it loud, we need it clear, we need it faithful, we need it encouraging. So God, we pray for your churches, we pray for your messages to continue to be preached. We pray for our well-being, our souls, our emotions, and our bodies. You know what we need at this time, God, whether it's physically, emotionally, or spiritually. And we know, God, that you will faithfully provide and faithfully comfort. So, God, we offer these prayers to you. We offer you our love. We offer you our prayers. We offer you our devotion. We offer this prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Let us join in our closing hymn, The Old Rugged Cross, so we know there is power in the cross. Of our worship today. Whether it's in the songs that have been sung, whether it's the prayers that have been prayed, or the messages that has been preached, we pray that it has been fulfilling and uplifting. Now the benediction. May the light of God shine upon you. May the love of God surround you. May the power of God protect you. And may the wisdom of God guide you. And as you leave this place of worship, may you know that wherever you go, God will be there too. Our benediction piece is May the Lord, Mighty God, followed by O Canada, as our tribute to our frontline responders. Thank you.